2y was 4x plus 8.
Oh, I thought she summoned the 30.
Did you say 30?
No, I said 30.
Okay, you did say 2. Alright. So, I'm going to give you the quick answer, like what I would do, just so that this problem looks like almost every other elimination problem thinks they're consistent. I'm going to get it so it looks like law x, law y equals blah. I need that blah x blah y equals blah. Okay, that's what I'm gonna get to. To make that happen, this equation, I see I have an x term over here. Over here, my y term on the other side of the equation, along with the number that I'm used to seeing by itself on one side. So how do I get it so that this 5y is no longer here on this side?
Subtract it.
Yeah, make sure you don't just like grab it and move it. That's not how equations work. You can't just move things from one side to the other.
Right.
Okay. We need to cancel this 5y by subtracting 5y from it. 5y minus 5 is 0. Minus 5y on this side.
What do we also do? Sorry to interrupt. What do we also do? Minus 4x on the bottom.
So yeah, I'll do that as well.
Okay.
So equation by equation. I'm going to write it in order of x and then y. So 7x, it's a positive 7x, minus 5y. Equals negative 8. And as Bridger said, let's subtract 4x from both sides. And so I'll write it in order x and then y. Negative 4x plus 2y equals 8. Okay. So now I don't have to look at it like this anymore. It looks kind of normal. Okay? And now I'm going to try and cancel something out. Try and cancel out maybe the y's. Can you turn that down, please? So sorry. Try to cancel these out, maybe going by getting them both be 10. 10, 1, negative 10. So multiply this one by what?
2.
2. And this one by?
5.
There you go. 2 times 7x, 14x. 2 times 5y, negative 10y. 2 times negative 8, negative 16. 5 times negative 4, negative 20x. 5 times 2y. There's the reason we did all that. 5 times 8, 16.
Oh, this is false. I mean,
no, it just equals 0.
I don't know, but
it's no solution.
I mean, yeah, no solution.
No, but 5 times 8 is 32.
What is it? Oh, 16.
Oh, okay. That makes sense.
Even if that did happen, I'll show you, but that doesn't mean no solution. 5 times 8 is 40. Not 16. So we add these together. 14x minus 20x is negative 6x. 0 there. 40 minus 16 is 24. Divide by negative 6. X is negative 4. Take negative 4. Plug that guy into wherever you want for x, like this one right here. Negative 4 times negative 4 plus 2y equals 8. So we have a positive 16 plus 2y equals 8, minus 16 on both sides, negative 8, y equals negative 4. So negative 4, negative 4. If two equations add together and the right side is 0, don't just assume that that means no solution or infinite solutions. Okay, so let's take 2x plus 5y equals 12, and 3x minus 5y equals negative 12. If I add these together, I do get a 0 over here, but I get 2x plus 3x is 5x. 5 times x equals 0. Does that have a solution?
Yeah.
Yeah. Divided by
is 0. Divided by 5. X equals 0. It's not no solution. X is just the number 0. Danielle?
Is that, well, you said that one was 3.
This is
a
review packet.
Oh, yeah, I was really confused. I was like, okay, well, I guess that's that.
No, so you have a whole other section, right? Okay. So that's 3. And, you know what to do with that. Take 0, plug it in. Cut.
So how do you have a false equation? Just 0 equals 0?
A false equation would be 0 equals 1. That's not true.
Oh, okay.
It'll happen when your equations look something like this, 2x plus 3y equals 5, or and then negative 2x minus 2y equals 9. Okay, well, 2x minus 2x is 0, 3y minus 3y is 0, so this side is all canceled out, because 0 equals 9 plus 5, that's 14. There is no way these two equations can have a solution that works in them both. Because essentially what happens if we like if we were to graph these two, they'd be parallel lines. They never would cross.
Okay. So if it says 0 equals 0, that means infinite solutions, right? Because
if I want to make this 0 equals 0, then I would need to make this a negative 5 out of negative 5. And what we have here is this equation times negative 1 on both sides, mm-hmm. You get this equation. They're the exact same equation. You can see the way you can see right here. So if we were to graph those, they'd be the same line. They would just overlap each other everywhere. And so there'd be an infinite number of solutions. Infinite number of times they cross, infinite number of x's and y's that work in both equations.
Okay.
0 equals 0, infinite. Something else is false. There's no solution.
I'm good.
Yeah.
Could we do number 36?
So as fast as can be, cats, x, food in ounces, so ounces of food is y, we have 1, 2, 3, 5.5, 11, and 16.5. The question, is the domain discrete or continuous? So we got like two vocab areas there. Which is the domain? What is the domain?
X.
All of the x's, right? The collection of all of the x's. Right? X represents a number of what?
Cats.
Would that be a discrete or a continuous domain? Aiden?
Discrete.
Explain why.
Because it's a whole number, not like half of it.
Yeah, so if we, when we think about it, if we can have half of that thing, or 0.25 of that thing, or any decimal fraction amount we want, like ounces. Ounces is a continuous thing, because I can have a half ounce, 3/4 of an ounce, 0.723 of an ounce, but I'm not going to have 0.723 of a cat. So the domain is continuous.
Oh, I thought.
Or sorry.
Discrete.
Discrete. The domain is discrete.
Can we do number 14?
Will we have time after today, or are you going to come in?
Well, you can always come in at your own time.
Okay.
14, so there's a plane. It's flying. There's wind. Okay. Since it's flying upwind, which means it's flying against the wind, right? It's the same as upriver means against the power of the river. Okay. It's flying a certain distance. That distance. 30 miles.
I feel like we've done something very similar to that.
This is the exact problem. So it's flying, and it would go a certain speed, except for the wind is fighting against it, taking away from that speed that it could go. That trip takes 30 minutes. Okay, so it gets to there, and it comes back. Coming back the other way. I know. It's we're gonna assume like if there were no wind, it would fly a certain speed, just like if there were no wind here, it would fly at the same speed. Okay. If there were no wind, it would just fly the same speed there and back. But because there's wind, it goes a little slower this way and a little faster this way. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And that certainly the data supports that because this trip takes 25 minutes, not 30 minutes. It's a little faster. What we're trying to figure out is the speed of the wind. What's the speed of the wind? So it's this thing. So the question's about speed, so we're probably going to want to work in terms of speeds, right? So like the wind has a speed, the plane has a speed. Here the plane and the wind, they're the same speeds as they were in the first scenario. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Like if the wind's blowing just as hard, so that's the same. If there were no wind at all, like I said before, it would have taken the same amount of time there and back because but it would have, like, its speed, no wind, should be constant, consistent all the time. So let's say that this speed is x and this speed is y. And this speed would be x, this speed would be y. And since we're talking about speeds, we should probably talk about how fast it went, like actual speed after the wind took away from its speed. How fast did it go? So if it goes 30 miles in 30 minutes, how fast was it going?
30 miles per hour.
30 miles per hour?
Oh, 60. 60.
30 minutes. 30 minutes in half an hour, right? We're just looking at miles per hour to set up that ratio of miles to hours. 30 divided by half, 30 times 2, or 1, multiplied by the reciprocal gives us 60 miles per hour.
This up there.
That's just how fast it went, fighting against the wind. Here it went 30 miles, right, miles per hour, in how many hours? How many hours is 25 minutes?
Just
quarter.
Under a half.
Not quite one quarter, 15 minutes would be a quarter, 60 minutes in an hour.
1/4.
No.
1/6.
Again, 15 would be 1/4 of an hour since there's 60 minutes in an hour, not 100.
I don't know what's wrong. 25 divided by 6.
You doing that point? 25/60.
Okay. 0.4166 would be the
number. So,
25/60. We simplify that. That's 5/12. Yeah. 5/12 of 1 hour multiplied by 12/5. 30 divided by 5 is 6. 6 times 12, 72. 72 miles per hour. To find the speed, just take the distance divided by the time. Speed is distance divided by the time.
Oh.
So on the trip there, where it's actually going slower, it's going 60 miles an hour. It's going 60 miles an hour because it's trying to fly, but the wind is fighting it. The other way it goes 72 miles an hour because it's flying and the wind is helping it. It's actually going faster than the plane could go because the wind's helping it. So let's talk about this trip. The speed of the plane and the speed of the wind together are how fast. Speeds together 72. It's kind of like this. The wind's kind of like a, think of it like a train, and think of the plane as you. Okay? So it's riding along on the wind, right? But it's also got its own speed that it can go, so they're kind of helping each other out. The speeds, the wind's helping the plane out. If you're on a train that's going 60 miles an hour, okay, and you can throw a fastball 90 miles an hour. On the train, it's going 60, you throw it 90, then how fast is the ball actually going to someone who's just
100,
sitting
30
on
miles
the side?
180.
180?
Wait, no.
30
miles per hour.
No, you're going this way, the train's going this way, and you're throwing the ball the same direction?
150.
Oh.
150?
No,
Would it be 90 plus 60?
Would it be? Well, you're already going 60 because of the train.
And then you're throwing,
and you're throwing 90 miles an hour.
So would it that be 150? It'd
be 150 miles an hour. The ball would be going to someone who's just standing on the ground up at the side, not on the train.
Right.
Someone on the train looks like it's 190. Someone off the train looks like it's 150. Mm-hmm. So this is like the train, and this is like the you, right? This is like your fastball. Right. So the wind speed and the plane's speed would, how would it combine them to get 72?
Oh, yeah. So then would it be 70 minus 30?
60 plus 12.
Well, let's set up the system of equations as it asks you to do. X and Y, how do they combine to make 60 miles an hour?
From the miles and the time.
Now, so if I'm flying at a certain speed and the wind is fighting me, like what is this speed doing to my speed to cause me to go 60 miles an hour?
Lowering it,
right? So if I were flying 100 miles an hour and the wind is blowing 20 miles an hour, then how fast would I actually wind up being able to go?
80,
right? So we just took 100 and 20 and did what with them?
Subtracted.
Right. So there's the plane speed x and the wind speed y. How do they go together to make this slower speed of 60. Subtract what from what?
X from what?
Which one from which one?
Y
minus X.
X minus Y. Planes flying take away the wind speed. If the wind is blowing fast enough, it actually is blowing it backwards, right?
Mm-hmm.
So planes flying, we subtract the speed of the air and went up to 60. If we write these equations vertically like this, can you see how we can solve the system of equations?
Oh, yeah.
How so?
Wouldn't you just do it like elimination or something?
Yeah, just add them together. 2x equals 72 plus 60.
132.
32 divided by 2, x is?
66.
66?
Yeah.
Yep.
It is, because 60 plus 60.
So x is the speed of the plane, we need to find the speed of the wind, so.
Plug it in.
66 plus y is 72. Subtract 66 from both sides.
Y equals 6.
See if that makes sense. It's fly. If it has a speed of 66, the plane can fly 66, right? But the wind takes away 6 miles per hour, 60 miles per hour. It's flying this way, 66 miles an hour. It gets a 6 mile an hour boost. It goes up to 72. Okay. We're really just plugging in that solution to both equations and seeing if it works out. Pretty classic, like this, the problem may be it's you're going up a river or down river, right? One way your speeds add together, one way your speeds subtract, one speed takes away from the other. And they add together to make a faster speed, one subtracts from the other to make a slower speed. Make sense? Okay. Just gotta figure out which is subtracting from which. Next.
Can we do number 13?
Sum of the digits of a two-digit number is 8. When the digits are reversed, the number increases by 18. Find the original number. So it's a little bit tricky, but like a two-digit number like 25, right? Well, you know, to add the digits together, what does it say? Add the digits together. The sum of the two digits of a two-digit number is 8. When the digits are reversed, the number increases by 18. Find the original number. Okay. So, now we've got a two-digit number. Let's call this digit x and this digit y. If I add the two digits together, what do we get?
8.
What's that? 8. 5 plus 3. 6 plus 2. If the digits are reversed, the number increases by 18. Find the original number. What do you think, Grace?
Would it be x plus y equals 18? And then subtract those two equations?
Well, if I read this right, it's saying that, say, 23 and 32, right? It switched the digits around. It's saying the difference between the larger number and the smaller number is 18. The number increases by 18. So if the number looks like this to start with, right? Then we should have like a number that looks like this, yx minus xy is 18. When we reverse it, it's bigger by 18. Except, we can't just say yx. Yx means y times x, and xy means x times y. Right? So how do we express this? I'm going to give you the quick answer here. In order to talk about, let's say, this number xy, it's really 10 times the digit x plus y. Just like this is 10 times 2 plus 5.
Oh, whoa. Okay.
So, we talk about this one, yx, where the digits are reversed. It's really 10, let's start over here, 10 times y plus x minus 10 times x plus y. This is where y is in the tens place, x is in the ones place. Now x is in the tens place and y is in the ones place, like this. That should come out to be 18. If you clean it up, you get, let's see, x minus 10x is negative 9x. And 10y minus y is 9y. Comes out to be 18. So I just distributed the negative and combined everything. So negative 9x plus 9y equals 18.
So if you did 9, wait, so.
Times by 9 on the top one.
Multiply by 9 on the top one? So these will be opposite?
Mm-hmm.
We get 9x plus 9y equals 72. These cancel out. 18y equals 72 plus 18 is 90.
Yeah.
Divide by 18. Y is equal to?
9. I'm guessing.
9?
No, not 9.
It's 5.
5?
Yeah. Maybe.
Y equals 5. So the second digit here is 5?
Yeah.
It's 3.
What's 3?
The other. 35.
The other one. Yeah. X is equal to 3 because 3 plus 5 is 8. So you're right. 35 and 53.
Okay.
What's the number? Is the number that we're looking for 53 or 35? What's the original version?
35.
35, yeah, when you reverse it, then it increases by 18. My goodness, Clint, you have an urgent question. Can't wait.
Oh,
go ahead.
Are you done? Okay, so this is a quick one, then I have a real one. Okay, so it says describe the domain and range. What does it mean when it says describe versus find the domain and range?
Which number?
Oh, on 17. You know, if you do it this way, this
is good.
Okay, so it's different because the domain and the range here are not just like 1, 2, 3, 4, continuous. So I need to somehow say the numbers between this number and that number. So this
so
one,
you just be like,
x can be anywhere between 0 and 2.
Okay, I get it.
Okay, why?
19.
Two numbers. Graph table to write a linear function that relates y to x.
Oh,
so
I got this. You had to do plus 12 for the bottom, and then plus 3 for the top.
5, 17, that seems to fit.
Mm-hmm.
29, so this goes up by 12, and this goes up by 12.
Mm-hmm.
This goes up by 12. I'm going to check all of them. If it didn't increase by the same amount, well, then the ratio would have to be the same, and if the ratio doesn't work out, then it's not even linear.
Right.
Negative 3.
0, 3, 6. Yeah. And then plus 3 on top.
So these go up by 3 each, okay.
Yep. And then you'd have to divide the y by the x.
The change in y by the change in x.
Yeah.
Okay. So 12 over 3 times x plus?
5.
5, because 5
is
the y where x is 0.
Yeah.
So y equals 4x plus 5.
Yep.
Okay. If you have a linear pattern, then the change in y, the change in x, is the thing you multiply by x, and you would add whatever x, if you plug in 0 to this function, whatever that y you get, that's what you put here, put it, it's put it, otherwise going to be y-intercept. Okay.
I'm ready for the test.
I'll have to explain it later, I just want to put it in your notebook, have it. Okay. Are you ready?
Yep.
You're
okay.
Let's
get ready quickly and we'll have more time. I have a correction to make as well while you're getting ready there. I think it'll make sense when you see it. There's a problem where you have choices A, B, C, D, and the other one should be E, F, G, H. But I don't know why these three are not right. Okay? So scratch out the three, whatever they look like there, and just replace them with F, G, H.
Yeah.
Makes sense. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. You just go in alphabetical order, but the letters that you'll see here are not F, G, and H. There's
no letter
and not fix it. No, you need to fix it. Because there's repeats. Letters.